Good evening. It's so nice to see all of you here. Dean Cutieta and I welcome you to this most wonderful event. I am Elizabeth Hines. I'm chair of vocal arts in the Thornton School of Music. It gives me great pleasure this evening to introduce to you our guest, James Conlon. Mr. Conlon, as you know, has been the music director of the Los Angeles Opera since 2006. Since 2005, he has been the music director of the Ravinia Festival, the summer home of the Chicago Symphony. And also since 1979, has continued as music director of the Cincinnati Music May Festival, America's oldest choral festival. In Europe, Mr. Conlon was the principal conductor of the Paris National Opera from 1995 to 2004. He was also the general music director of the City of Cologne from 1989 to 2002, and music director of the Rotterdam Philharmonic from 1983 to 1991. As guest conductor, James Conlon has maintained a 30-year association with Metropolitan Opera and with all the major orchestras and opera houses throughout Europe and North America. In an effort to raise public consciousness to the significance of two generations of composers who were suppressed, forced to immigrate, or were executed by the Nazi regime, Mr. Conlon has devoted himself to extensive programming of their music. His multi-year project at the Los Angeles Opera, Recovered Voices, continues this year with a company premiere and a new production of Walter Braunfels' The Birds. Here in Los Angeles, it is our great fortune to regularly hear the voice of James Conlon through the brilliant language of his music. And tonight we are indeed fortunate to hear James Conlon's voice as an educator and as an advocate for those silenced by oppression. Please join me in welcoming James Conlon.
Thank you for your very warm welcome, and thank you, Elizabeth, if I may call you Elizabeth, and in the presence of all many of your students here. We see each other every summer in Aspen. Elizabeth, I suspect this is the first time you've seen me with a tie on ever. I dressed up for you guys in order to feel professorial, which I'm not at all, but I do have a tie and a suit, and so I thought I ought to put it on this occasion. I'm delighted to be with you. I'm delighted to. This is my first, the first time I've stepped on this campus, really, and I'm thrilled to be here. As I am thrilled to be your neighbor. I guess 10 minutes in the car, in good traffic, and I hope that I'll be able to have other occasions in which to speak to you. And I hope that you'll have plenty of occasions to come down to see what we do at LA Opera, because that's my life, that's what I devote my life to, and that's what's most important to me, and I'd like to share as much of that with you and as many of you as possible. Tonight's discussion is entitled, What Happens When Art Clashes With Its Society or With Society in General. And I'm going to divide the talk up into several parts, well, two parts while I talk, and then I'm going to open up to everybody to questions and answers. I like to do that. I mean, sometimes it's a little bit the token in the last 5 minutes. You get to scramble to see who gets their question in. But I'll leave you plenty of time for the questions, because I've often had the experience of blathering on, and at the end of an hour, I get about 20 questions that have nothing to do with anything I said. And so I want to be sure that there may be things on your mind, there may be things that I don't think that I have not thought to say about. So the two parts will, under the heading of what happens when society and art clash. I'm going to take a very, very focused look on a particular era, and then I'm going to take a look at 2008 in the United States and pose questions which are the other side of that coin. I have to admit to a prejudice, and because you'll certainly hear it, but I'm going to put it right out in front of. When I'm now referring to art, I am talking about classic art. And classic, I'm talking about the arts in general. I'm talking about graphic arts. I'm talking about literature. I'm talking about dance and ballet, and I'm talking about classical music. My prejudice about classical music, I think, is self-explanatory. I've spent from early adolescence, that's 11 years old, completely in love, in a passionate relationship with classical music. I live for it. It inhabits my being. It stays with me day and night, and has since I'm a young man. I'm not at all saying that everybody has to feel that way, but given that prejudice and given that that I have spent all my life, I believe absolutely in the absolute value of classical music and classical arts. And so I wouldn't be up here today. I'm not a professor. I have a bunch of honorary doctors, but I was so impatient I barely made it through the end of conservatory. I wouldn't wait to get out of school. I don't come as an educated person or as an educator in any sense of the word. I come as an advocate. I come as somebody who believes very strongly in the importance and the power of music in general. There has never been a society without music, and a society, a theoretic society without music can't exist. In other words, a society that has lost its relationship to music has lost its soul. That being said, classical music is a choice. Classical music, of which we're referring to, is a basically European cultural accomplishment which was imported into the United States in the 19th century and which has flourished in the United States, and I believe very strongly in its importance. So what I'm going to be focusing on is when it comes to that clash in society, we're going to looking at probably the worst example in 20th century history, if not all of Western civilization, of the most systematic suppression of art and artists by a particular regime at a particular time. And of course, I'm referring to the years of 1933 to 1945. I'm talking about the suppression and genocide of the Nazi regime. I'm talking about the loss to the what had been the longest, most uninterrupted flowering of classical music in the German-speaking countries and in Europe in general. And to look at that as an example of the extreme damage that can be can come of an authoritarian regime and censorship in its extreme, and to see that the effects of that are long-lasting, that they did not stop in 1945, but the damage done by that has continued. And my thesis is that still today, many of the composers' compositions and victims of that have been lost to us. And so it is something that we have the right, from the point of view of the inheritors of a great civilization, we have the right to know about those compositions, those pieces of art, those pieces of literature that got lost in that terrible time. It is not the only terrible time. It is not the only example in history of either genocide or the wholesale destruction of culture. Unfortunately, it's not the only example. One can look to the destruction of the pre-Columbian cultures in South America, and although we have of course artifacts, we have some architecture, there's a lot there. This is probably a fraction of what was there. So this is not something that is limited. This discussion is only about what happened in Nazi Germany, because it very, very specifically impacted a tradition of classical, well, all the classical arts, and specifically I'll talk about classical music tonight. The Stalinist Soviet Union, probably the crimes are as great, maybe greater, although we don't know as many facts. We don't know as much about the cultural revolution in China. There are many times where wholesale suppression of art and artists, writers, is unfortunately a part of human history. So I want to look a little bit first at those times, and to start out, I have. I brought a few papers. I usually don't read very much at these when I speak, but there are a few short paragraphs and a few ideas I want to be able to read to you from various articles I've written over a certain amount of time. This is a very short one, just explaining that my theme and mission is the revival of works of classical music suppressed by the Nazi regime between 1933 and 1945. They have been left unperformed, widely unknown, and underappreciated for far too long. At a conservative count, dozens of significant composers, hundreds of major compositions, and even thousands of smaller ones were banned from public performance, if not destroyed. Their composers' fates were as varied as their music. Those who could fled and immigrated, many to the United States, or simply went into hiding. Other lives were shortened through the stress of the suppression. In several significant cases, some perished in concentration camps. Now, my relationship to this whole subject, by the way, it goes back about 15 years, not longer than that. I would like to propose this to you. For those of you who are classical music lovers, I would say, well, you know, I really feel bad that I don't know anything about this. First of all, you should not feel bad at all. Most people don't. And I'll give you myself as an example. I fell in love with classical music as an 11-year-old. I immediately asked my parents to have piano lessons and violin lessons, and within 2 years I knew exactly what I wanted to do with my life, which in certain respects is a blessing in life because you're able to focus yourself. There are two types, in a certain sense, two types of experiences. You find what you want to do and you try to do it, or there's another very rich type of experience, which is you don't know what you want to do, and life finds you, and there are certain freedoms that a person who doesn't know or hasn't found it yet has, as opposed to a person who does. My freedom was that I was free to concentrate and focus, but at the same time locked into and almost into a discipline which can become a slavery, where you deny yourself so many things because you can't. The other side, or those to a person who's looking, hasn't found it yet, you have an openness to life and a freedom in that openness that you can enjoy maybe all your life. Now, I started out as somebody who absolutely focused, wanted to know everything that could be known about classical music and other things too, but I'll leave those out. I started professionally conducting at the age of 19 years old, had my first real experiences at 21. I was therefore in the a practicing professional musician with an international career before I heard a single piece of any of this music. I discovered them, I was in my early 40s, and I had known a few names, but I had no personal or direct experience with the names or the music of the composers, many of the composers who had been suppressed, which means that even a person devoting their entire lives to a professional life of classical music, it was possible to go through decades and decades and decades without any kind of contact at all. Now, I was fortunate to have, and it's simple, I'm sure some of you have had this experience, you hear something on the radio, I happened to be in my car, I was living in Germany at the time, and I switched on the radio late at night after I was had conducted and had gone to have dinner and was driving home, turned on my car, heard something fantastically beautiful, wonderful, and you know, you get home and what usually happens, you turn off the radio in the car, you run inside, you turn on the radio inside, and it's gone. It's finished. You missed what it was. Now, well, I was out there in my car thinking to myself, I can't miss this. I must know what this is. Otherwise, it'll be like the lost chord. I'll suffer it all my life. I want to know what this piece was. And so I sent out there, to my shame, and I'll admit it, I polluted the atmosphere for 20 minutes in my car out there, because I was midway through a piece of a composer whose name happened to be Alexander Zemlinsky, whom I then proceeded to fall in love with. And from my first experiences of falling in love with one composer, I then read about and discovered other composers, and then that expanded outward to the point that I realized that the only reason we don't know about those composers and those compositions is because of the suppression and the genocide that was committed by the Third Reich in those years. You know, we often have certain prejudices and think, well, you know, there are several cliches that one hears a lot, and I've certainly heard them in regards to reviving this music. One is, there are no lost masterpieces. This is the idea, is that if something has never been heard of or is not known, it's not worth knowing. I'd like to attack that cliche on many levels, not just in the context of what I'm talking about today, but for you to say that there are no, well, for one to say that there are no lost masterpieces, I'd like to present as an example. I'd like to ask you about pre-Columbian art, pre-Columbian architecture, pre-Columbian culture. Entire civilizations have been destroyed. In fact, the rule has been over human history that the victors in war can destroy, can make use of whatever they wish to when they destroy, and very often have done so consciously. The conquistadores in South America, there's no question that they destroyed a culture. There has never been an example of a war where the victors did not, in some way or other, damage the culture. Now, fortunately, sometimes enlightened victors know how to preserve the culture that they are conquering, but that certainly was not an issue a long time ago, and many cultures have been, many masterpieces have been destroyed in those wars and in those times. If any of you would like to know if masterpieces get destroyed in our present day world, I can remind you that many of us saw broadcast on CNN the destruction of those Buddhas in Afghanistan, and we saw it with our own eyes, two masterpieces, irreplaceable, exploded in front of for the entire world to see. So unfortunately, that is still an occurrence, and the idea that there are no lost masterpieces is one that I give no currency to this. And another correlative of this is the best product will always float to the top. This is another way of saying, if you haven't heard of it, it's not worth knowing. We live now, certainly in 2008, in the midst of a culture where marketing and advertising have become an art in and of themselves. Art, wait a minute, I'm going to take that right back. They have become, I don't want to use a derogatory term, but it has become a technique. Let's call it a technique. The technique to sell a product or to sell an idea has now become an independent form and profession and expertise. And so there is a larger space in between knowing a product and hearing what is said about it. And consequently, we make certain assumptions that if you haven't heard of a particular product, I'm not going to buy that radio, or I'm not going to buy that latest technology because I haven't heard of it. I'm going to take cover under the names that I know, the big brand names, the designer clothes, all of those sort of things. Well, many good products die not because they are bad products, but because some other product was able to market itself in a more effective manner. So this also, I think, has some effect on the way we view past masterworks or past music. We say, well, never heard of it, can't be good. Why? Well, it can't be good. Well, it wasn't marketed. Well, marketing, of course, wasn't the same in the 1920s and 1930s. But nevertheless, we have unconsciously adopted certain prejudices, like, I don't know what that is, I've never heard of it, therefore I don't need to hear it. And I encounter this often as a guest conductor with, sometimes also with my own orchestras, a concern, particularly in the United States, that unknown names will discourage people from coming to a concert. In other words, if you have Beethoven and Tchaikovsky and Dvorak and Brahms, you're on safe ground, and then it's enough to introduce a single unknown name, and the risk at the box office is too great. I'm getting ahead of myself because that's the second part of this discussion tonight. But to go back to the cliches and prejudices, I believe that there are masterpieces from the past that are not particularly well known. I believe that there is also a great deal of art that we don't need to call masterpieces. In fact, it's not possible to all, we don't really, in reading literature and looking at art, it doesn't really matter, I think, in the end, if every piece is a masterpiece. We're getting the sense of a time, we're getting the sense of a genre, we're getting the sense of a certain approach to art which represents a time in history. And that's, to me, what is more important. So I'm not proposing that every piece of music that has been lost during the Second World War or during the years previous to that is the Mona Lisa or the Sistine Chapel or the Beethoven Ninth. And in fact, it's not even important to me. I don't think those judgments even need to be made. I think the music essentially has to be listened to and experienced for what it is. And all of those natural feelings and come up with you for the way you would listen to any other piece of music, whether it be known, whether it be Bach or Mozart or Debussy or Stravinsky, or pretty much any work that we call classic music. So, what do I mean by classical music or what the classical arts that makes these pieces relevant is it's very difficult to define classical. You know, there's a wonderful book, essay, What is a Classic, of T.S. Eliot, which goes into a lot of that in depth. But I think in trying to just put certain ideas simply about what becomes a classic to us, I think it's universally said, well, it's the test of time. The test of time is, does a particular piece of literature, a drama, a play, a ballet, a piece of music, can it be appreciated a century later, 2 centuries later, 500 years later? And if the answer is yes, if there is value in reading these works, seeing that painting that was painted 300 years ago, if there's value in that, we say it has tested, passed the test of time. In other words, something that was written in another era, usually in another place, so that it's traveled through space and time. In other words, a painting made in Moscow 200 years ago is classic art if we find that it appreciates it. We do make judgments. Now, whether judgments are correct or incorrect is another issue. A piece of music written 200 years ago is classic because we listen to it after 200 years. So, my point about the importance of the composers and compositions that have been lost through suppression and genocide is that they were not eliminated because it was not worthy music or interesting music or irrelevant music. These composers, for the most part, were not extraterrestrials or beings that came from another planet, and why should we be interested? They were an integral part of the greatest single, greatest single classical tradition in mostly in the Germanic countries, which had been uninterrupted from before the time of Johann Sebastian Bach, and that they were an integral part of it, and they were weeded out not on artistic merit at all. They were weeded out for the most part as a part of genocide, in certain cases just for political expediency. I've written a little paper I'm going to excerpt. I've written this is a sort of an artistic credo. I wrote it about 5 years ago, but I think it lays out the biggest picture. And please forgive me for reading, but I think it may be of some worth. I called it Recovering a Musical Heritage, the Music Suppressed by the Third Reich. And I open it with a short quote of Siegfried Sassoon's, which comes from a poem. And the quote is, "Who shall absolve the foulness of their fate? Those doomed, conscripted, unvictorious ones." Okay. After 1945, those who performed, wrote, or taught classical music worked in a culture scarred by omissions. These were not of their making, but were part of the legacy of the atrocities committed in Nazi Germany. With its racist ideology and systematic suppression, particularly, although not exclusively, of Jewish musicians, artists, and writers, the Third Reich silenced two generations of composers, and with them, an entire musical heritage. Many who perished in concentration camps and others whose freedom and productivity were curtailed were fated to be forgotten after the war. Their music seemed to have passed with them, lost in silence. However, more lost music has survived than was at first thought. It has taken decades of dedicated work to recover and publish it. We must now mitigate a great injustice by working to revive the music of those whose only fault, in quotes, was that they were Jewish or they were opposed or deemed offensive to an authoritarian regime. But that is not the only reason to restore the works. I believe that the spirit of this lost generation now needs to be heard. The creativity of the first half of the 20th century is far richer than we think. Alongside of Stravinsky, Strauss, and other major and more fortunate figures, the varied voices of composers from Berlin, Vienna, Prague, and Budapest, whether Jewish, dissident, or immigrant, reveal much about the musical ferment of their time. Their music is, I believe, accessible and relevant. Further, our own American heritage owes an enormous debt to those who emigrated to Hollywood, and we're particularly well-placed here to appreciate that in Los Angeles, and to Broadway, bringing their distinctive personalities with them and creating a style that has since become distinctly American. Parenthetically, I want to say here that there is no question that the United States has benefited from the two terrible wars in Europe. And both of these wars have brought with them an emigration that has really brought, in many cases, the cream of European culture, and this is certainly true in my profession. In my profession, classical music, where our orchestras were absolutely peopled with Europeans until we were able to build our own conservatories, our own tradition. The cliches that there are no lost masterpieces reveals our own ignorance. Entire civilizations, along with their masterpieces, have been destroyed by war since the beginning of human history. Various forms of censorship have repeatedly affected artists and works and continue to do so. And I'll return to that shortly when I discuss 2008. The suppression of these composers and musicians caused the greatest single rupture in what had been a continuous, seamless transmittal of German classical music. This centuries-old tradition, dating back from before Bach, was passed on from one generation to the next. It was nourished by the free expression of an often contentious creative exchange between conservative, traditional artistic modes of expression and competing currents of innovation and iconoclasm. The policies of the Third Reich destroyed the environment. Again, a parenthesis. I think this is very important for us to understand that it is not just that it destroyed certain individuals and lives, but it destroyed the environment in which there was free exchange and communication between artists, between writers, between musicians, and all of the polemics and the competition that comes with that. And that's what's so important, of course, in university life, for instance, that there's a place where we all can come together, you all can come together, and you learn, but at the same time you exchange ideas and you can disagree with each other. And through often disagreeing with each other and confronting each other's viewpoints, our culture develops, our civilization develops. This ruining of the environment is part of what did so much damage to classical music. The policies of the Third Reich destroyed the environment in which this could flourish, murdering an entire generation of its greatest talents, uprooting a garden with its creative polemics, and dialectics, forcing those who survived to scatter where there was no comparable artistic milieu in which to live and create. This immense self-destructive act seriously damaged its most cherished tradition, killing its caretakers and buried a lost generation and its spirit within. In other words, the irony that in the atrocious ideas of Hitler and the master race, and that he would inflict German culture on the entire world, in fact proved in the end to be the most self-destructive act possible. He actually destroyed one of the greatest parts of not just German culture, but one of the glories of all of Western civilization, which was the artistic and literary and philosophic environment to be found in Germany, and that to which, after 1933, was subject to this terrible destructive act. There are three aspects to be taken into consideration: moral, historical, and artistic. And this I will speak about briefly after I've finished this. Neither moral nor historical considerations would be reason enough for revival were it not for the artistic quality of what we have lost. This cannot be judged by a single hearing of tokenistic or uncommitted performances. Judgments, if indeed they must be made, can only be made after those performing and listening over the course of years have given the spirit of that era sufficient time to be fully digested. Okay? There are three aspects to be taken into consideration: moral, historical, and artistic. Undoing injustice when one can is a moral mandate for all citizens of a civilized world. We cannot restore to these composers their lost lives. We can, however, return the gift which would mean more to them than any other, and that's to play their music. Our perspectives on the history of 20th century classical music are incomplete because of an enormous quantity of works that have remained unplayed, and the lives of its composers largely ignored. History is not only made by big names, its warrior kings, dictators, and the most famous artists, but by the collective action of all of those artists who live in a given era. The 20th century needs to be re-scrutinized after we acquaint ourselves with the voluminous music cast out by the Nazi suppression. So, again, as I pass by those three categories, moral, historical, and artistic, why do I address it on a moral level? Because, frankly, because my parents brought me up that way, to confront any injustice, and if you can change that injustice, to do so, and that is a moral obligation. The historical question is, seems to me that the obligation, the mandate of historians is to constantly revisit the past, constantly revisit history with every piece of new knowledge, with every piece of information that has not been looked at clearly. There would be no discipline of history. You would not be a historian if you do not believe in the contemporary importance of old facts. And that is what history is made of. Now, the entire history of classical music in the 20th century has been written, passed on, taught in conservatories, and certainly my musical education included no information whatsoever on any of these composers, or even of the importance of what happened in Nazi Germany to art. This has to be corrected. We cannot say we know the 20th century and classical music as long as there is an enormous part of it that is missing. Now, afterwards, people can make judgment, say, "Well, I don't like that music," or "This composer interests me, and that." That one doesn't now. And I can assure you that I've gotten letters from people deeply indignant saying, "Well, you know, why don't you admit that this music is awful," or something like that. I've been attacked on neo-Nazi bloggers and sites. This is not of concern to me. I don't expect, or do I really think it's important, that every piece is pleasing to every person. What is important for me is that it is out there so people can react that way and say, "Well, I like this and I don't like that," which of course is very important. But when it comes to history, we have an obligation to to look into the history of this, of these composers and their compositions, because history is history. It all existed, it was all relevant, and somehow it needs to be included. But neither the moral aspects or the historical aspects would be important if it were not for the artistic value of the compositions in question. And here, yes, I'm dogmatic in insisting that it be heard and that people become acquainted with it. Why do I say that? If I ran down some of the names, I think you will know some of them, but many of them you will not know, their stories are deeply entwined with the names of those you know. I'll use Alexander Zemlinsky as an example, because this is the composer who led me to fall in love with his music first and to become interested in the entire subject. This is a man who was admired by most of his contemporaries in a very deep fashion. He was adopted by Gustav Mahler. He was promoted by Gustav Mahler. He was the brother-in-law of Arnold Schoenberg. That's, his sister was Schoenberg's first wife. On a parenthetical and a more slightly amusing story, I'm sure many of you have heard of Alma Schindler, later to become Alma Mahler, one of the great, great personalities of the turn of the century in Vienna, who to some is viewed as a great icon of woman's self-empowerment and a woman of brilliant intellect, and others, males usually view her as the great siren of her time. She had a very, very successful career of making geniuses fall in love with her. She was kissed on the lips by Gustav Klimt at the age of 18, I believe it was. Why do we know this? Because she wrote it in her diary. And we also learned that she was furious at her mother, who read her diary and found this fact. She, as you do know, she became the wife of Gustav Mahler and was then known from there on as Alma Mahler. During her marriage to Mahler, she had an affair with Kokoschka, she had an affair with Walter Gropius. She subsequently, after Mahler's death, would marry Walter Gropius while having an affair with Franz Werfel. She then married Franz Werfel. You know, she did come here to Southern California, and she spent her last years living here. And I'm told the fact that she met a young, brilliant Viennese theologian and priest at a meeting out here, and he became her last lover here. And she said, "I've never known that one of my lovers would say Mass for me." She had a great career. I am proud to tell you, because I believe in the greatness of Alexander Zemlinsky, that Alexander Zemlinsky is the first in the series. I left him out. He was the first of her great loves, and she dumped him unceremoniously when she could move on to somebody else, and that happened to be Gustav Mahler. He's a very colorful individual, Zemlinsky. Arnold Schoenberg, who, as you know, lived here, and I've had the honor of sitting in his armchair in his very home here, and to know his son, his daughter-in-law, and his grandson, and their families. Arnold Schoenberg and Alexander Zemlinsky were lifelong colleagues and friends, and Schoenberg was a man of deeply critical individual, wrote at the end of his life, I have always believed that Alexander Zemlinsky is a great composer, and his time will come. He wrote that in 1948 before he died. He wrote already in the 20s of how Zemlinsky was probably, since Richard Wagner, the person who understood the needs of musical theater better than anybody else. It's pretty high praise. Igor Stravinsky, another man who also lived in Southern California and who certainly was one of the unkindest tongues in classical music, whether writing or speaking, was asked once, what was the greatest performance he had ever seen from a conductor, and he named Alexander Zemlinsky. So that should give you just one example of an individual who, by the way, fled the Nazis twice, once from Berlin and once from Vienna, and spent out his last years living between Columbus Avenue and Amsterdam Avenue on the Upper West Side of Manhattan, ignored and isolated at the end of his life. One of many, many stories. I'll name a few other names. Viktor Ullmann, a Czech composer who was sent to the concentration camp in Terezin, was there for 2 years, wrote over 20 compositions in the concentration camp, a monument to the human will, before his transport to Auschwitz, where he died. His music was missing between 1945 and the 1970s. For 30 years it was missing. It was all found in London and has been performed since then. Pavel Haas, Czech. Terezin also died in Auschwitz. Eric Korngold, who of course came to Hollywood and made the modern movie music what it is. Carl Amadeus Hartmann, not Jewish, but a person who had opposed Hitler from the time of the Putsch, in other words, in Munich. He knew of Hitler in the 1920s, opposed him, went underground for all of the war years. Erwin Schulhoff, Czech intellectual, far-leaning, left-leaning Jewish intellectual, great in the avant-garde, died in the concentration camp, having continued to write until his death. Pavel Hask, Terezin, died in Auschwitz. Walter Braunfels, whose opera The Birds we will be performing here at LA Opera in the spring, this opera of The Birds was produced in Munich in 1920. It was the most popular opera of the year, conducted by Bruno Walter. Had to go into hiding during the war years. Kurt Weill, you will know because he came to America. You will know his name. You will know his name associated with Broadway and associated with the popular songs, but fewer of us know about the compositions that were written before he had to leave Germany. I mentioned the name of Franz Schreker, probably the most successful opera composer between 1910 and 1922 or 23 and 24, banned by the Nazis in 1933, and so on and so on and so on. There are famous names, you know, Arnold Schoenberg, Paul Hindemith, both of whom came to America, were able to establish themselves here, but not everybody was that lucky. Now, what happened after the war years is that it's always said that the victors write history, the survivors write history as well. Those composers who survived, or the schools of those composers that survived, were not necessarily aware of or were unkind to this generation, partially because of the dogmatism of two movements. One was serialism, the 12-tone practice conceived of and executed and then passed on by Arnold Schoenberg was, of course, a great genius. But what happened is that the orthodoxy after Schoenberg's death in the 1950s and 60s and even into the 70s was such that if you didn't write serial music, you could not be taken seriously. And the same happened with the advent of electronic music. And by the way, one of those composers, Franz Schreker, was the first made some of the first experiments in electronic music in the end of the 1920s. Electronic music had the same effect. So that many people were not willing to go back to looking at these composers, partially because also they were not through with tonality. They were not necessarily all adherents or disciples of Schoenberg. Now, many of them were, or were very big admirers, but they were still willing to make peace, as it were, between the popular world and the very, very academic world, or the world that you could be characteristic of as the avant-garde. They were viewed with some disdain after the war, and so it's common to say amongst German musicologists, and by the way, I was in Germany when I learned about this subject, and I must say that the one country that has done more than any other country to right this wrong and to make up for this, it is Germany. And modern German musicologists and musicians are far more aware of the existence of this music and have done more to promote it than in any other country. We in the United States are far behind, and so after living in Europe for 20 years and having spent my years in Germany and France, I determined that when I would return basically to live back in my own country again, that this would be a high priority to me to bring this to more attention. Other factors that went into the non-reemergence of these composers, there was no generation to pass this on. Generally, German music has been passed on from generation to generation by teachers to students, teachers to students. In fact, even the orchestras were developed this way, that to preserve certain local traditions, ways of playing the violin or certain kinds of sound, the teachers, the professors of who were in the orchestra, the Vienna Philharmonic, as an example, generally passes its new generation or the students of the old generation. That's how tradition was passed on in Germany. There was no generation there to pass it on in 1945. First of all, the German orchestras had been emaciated, and largely because of genocide. Now, the extraordinary accomplishment of Jewish musicians at most of those orchestras were largely Jewish, and of course, all of those musicians were lost to the future. So there was no generation to, there was no professor, there was no older generation to pass it on. Many of the musicians dead or immigrated. The institutions had to be rebuilt, but then they were going to be rebuilt with people who did not know or had no interest in those composers to begin with. And don't forget that anti-Semitism was not dead in 1945, that many of the surviving persons who were going to rebuild those institutions, although not culpable or not directly culpable in the genocide, had no sympathy whatsoever, or just simply wanted to stay away from the whole question. Now, interestingly enough, many Jewish survivors, Jewish musicians, also wanted to put it behind them. They were the experiences, the traumas were too painful, and very often it was too painful for them to look back and to remember. Now, some of those great conductors, for instance, who came to the United States, like Bruno Walter. Oh, I just mentioned that Bruno Walter conducted the premiere of The Birds, for instance, by Walter Braunfels, the opera we'll be doing in the spring at LA Opera. Otto Klemperer conducted the premiere of Zimlinski's opera, The Dwarf, which we performed a year ago. Paul Hindemith was the concertmaster for several premieres of Franz Schreker. And they themselves had a lot of difficulty looking back and didn't want to look back as much. And besides which, Bruno Walter and Otto Klemperer were very happy to have work here in the United States, and they were asked to conduct Brahms and Beethoven, so they conducted Brahms and Beethoven. They both championed Mahler, but it took many, many, many years. Gustav Mahler, by the way, was one of these composers. His music was banned, it was not taken seriously in many quarters, and being Jewish, he simply was out. The last city in the world to accept Gustav Mahler's music in modern times was Vienna, the place where he was the potentate and his very, very culture. If it hadn't been for Dimitri Metropoulos, a Greek, and Leonard Bernstein, our greatest American conductor, who imposed Mahler on the public, some of this would never have happened. And in a certain way, I take my inspiration from Leonard Bernstein, because I grew up in New York in the Bernstein years, I saw that one man's commitment and one man's stubbornness about certain issues did make the difference. Okay, it was time for Mahler's, it was time for his music to be recognized for what it was. He did the same with Copland, he did the same with many American composers, he did the same with Nielsen, he did the same with Charles Ives. But I saw that one person's obstinacy is enough to put the issue on the radar and for there to be development after that. That inspires me, and I think that's part of why I feel that this is so issue. And remember that if it hadn't been for Mendelssohn, we might not know Bach today. That Bach was unplayed until the revival that Felix Mendelssohn promoted. And so it is never too late to bring music back from the past and have it become again what it is, which is a part of our heritage. So the environment was gone after the war, and it's taken many, a full generation, in fact, almost the cycle from the dogmatism of the serial and the electronic music that evolved, a dogmatism that I believe Arnold Schoenberg would not have approved of. In the same way that Freud is said to have said at the end of his life, "I'm not a Freudian," I think that in many, many respects, this would not have been pleasing to Arnold Schoenberg. I think he was a man in the avant-garde who was a creator and created a system, and I cannot imagine that he meant that system to be the only form of music, or that it would, that would be the only form of the future. So we've looked in that now to what are the devastating effects of a very specific time of history, and that basically 70 years after these events, that we still do not have that music back, and that destruction is so easy, and creativity and reconstruction are so difficult. To me, the Nazi regime is still enjoying a posthumous victory. Their point was to stifle the voice of these composers, as well as literature and artists. Their goal was to stifle and destroy this voice. And the fact is, to some degree, that victory has been allowed to stand, and I'm determined in my little way, just by being stubborn and obstinate, to challenge that victory and to turn that victory around. Now, what does that mean for 2008? I've wrote all sorts of thoughts here, and they're random. Do we have, are we experiencing anything similar to this, to what went on in Nazi Germany? Well, thank goodness we are not. There is, at least in most Western countries, no authoritarian suppression of art, free speech, to anything that comparable, no. And yet, don't we have to ask ourselves, is our art, and again, my prejudice, I'm talking about classical art, I'm talking about classical literature, I'm talking about classical music and dance, or ballet, and the graphic arts, is our art, our classical art, in conflict with our society? And I think the answer is, we have to look, and I'm going to ask a lot of questions, I don't necessarily have answers about things, but I would like to just inspire you to think about some of these questions and to go more deeply into these questions than we're able to go to do tonight. But there is, in a way, a more subtle form or forms of censorship in our own society than we may be willing to recognize at first blush. Now, there was such a thing as censorship even in classical music, and I think that the 19th century censorship in Italy was probably the most famous and the most important of this. Giuseppe Verdi, clearly the greatest composer of Italian music and one of the great transcendent geniuses of Western civilization, had to submit every opera libretto and story to the censors so that they would decide whether or not it was acceptable. And this was mainly for political reasons. Remember that much of Italy, they were city-states up until 1870, were under domination of the French or the Austrians or some foreign power, or in many cases of the Catholic Church. There was no question that every work could not in any way do anything to be fomenting revolution or uprisings. And Verdi was a political figure from the very beginning of his life. So take any opera like Rigoletto, which people love, is all about the Duke of Mantua. Well, it wasn't about the Duke of Mantua. It was taken from a Victor Hugo play called Le Roi s'amuse, and it was about one of the most powerful kings in the history of Europe, François Premier of France. It wasn't about a little duke in a tiny, tiny little city in Italy. It was about, but you couldn't put a play that gives a very negative view of the king or the duke on stage. A Masked Ball, famous opera by Verdi, was about the assassination of King Gustav of Sweden, who was murdered at a masked ball, a subject that was treated in the opera many times. What is that now? You go and you read, you go to the Masked Ball, you see Count Ricardo and his aide, whose name is Renato, and his wife, his name Amelia, and he is the governor of Boston. And two counts who were the two of the assassins are named Sam and Tom. So, I mean, you see what happened to Verdi. Now, that was censorship, and it was normal at the time. Now, we don't have that really anymore in our country, although there are those people that would be very happy to see all forms of censorship come back in not just in the arts, but in other walks of life. But we at least for the moment, we don't have it. But we do have more subtle forms, and I would like to propose to you that the box office and market values have an enormous effect on the arts. And how do I come to that conclusion? Because I see it from inside. All arts institutions are fighting to keep themselves alive and well financially. And if you think that was true a year ago or even a month ago, we all are reeling from what has just happened. Now, we don't know if things may improve or we may be able to take the the shock absorbers may be able to absorb this, and certainly institutions, all of the cultural institutions have gone through difficult times in the past, and I think they will survive, I think we will survive, I think we will be able to, we will certainly find a way to manage in these times, but this is of course a very difficult time for the institutions. It's all about, in the end, being able to afford classical art. Classical art has always been expensive, and classical art has also always been patronized. There is not a single time in history of Western civilization that the great arts, what I call classical arts, have paid for themselves. How many of the great authors of classical literature, whether in Russia, whether in France, whether in Italy, whether in England, whether in the United States, had a guaranteed living? Most of those writers struggled. If they were lucky, they made ends meet. They were not the great, the rich, the famous, the celebrated. They were struggling artists. Their books did not make money. Now we have bestsellers and we have bestseller lists, and we see that some of our popular authors end up being multimillionaires. That didn't exist for the most part, and certainly artists were the last ones to be able to profit. When you think that, for instance, Vincent van Gogh, any one of his paintings will sell for millions and millions and millions, and then you read the life of van Gogh and you understood what he went through, and is only one of many, many examples. Well, the arts have never paid for themselves, and they have never been, until our century, a source of enrichment. And if you want to go right back to that, you start at the Renaissance. The Renaissance would never have been possible without the Medici families and the other powerful families of Florence. The Renaissance art would never have existed if it hadn't been for the enormous power and wealth of the Roman Catholic Church, who sponsored and who gave artists work. All you have to do, you go to St. Peter's and you see what a monument to classical art those structures are. The Sistine Chapel, the sculptures of Michelangelo, Leonardo da Vinci, these were all because of patronage. None of these works sold for money, that they didn't exist. Now, gradually, all of the composers, if they existed through the 18th century, they did it because they had a job. Bach had a job at a small church in Leipzig, and that's how he made his living. And he didn't think of promoting his music. He didn't think of making money with his music. He was very meticulous about his money, because we know that from his diaries. But he basically wrote for every Sunday service, and that's why we today in 2008 have the richness of Johann Sebastian Bach, because he got a job in a church. And so on and so forth. You go down the line and see that they all were dependent on the patronage of the Esterházy House for Haydn. Mozart, when he was lucky, had the Archbishop of Salzburg, but he didn't like the Archbishop of Salzburg, so he went to try to do it on his own in Vienna and died a pauper and is buried in a pauper's grave. Beethoven fought to pay his bills all of his life. Wagner, probably the greatest genius of the 19th century and the biggest megalomaniac of all of the composers, though he was convinced that he was the greatest genius in the world, and he wasn't wrong in certain respects, couldn't pay his bills all of his life and lived off the generosity of strangers, friends, his mistresses, the husbands of his mistresses, borrowed money from everybody he knew and rarely paid it back, borrowed other people's wives and didn't give them back. This is the rule, not the exception. Now, in our time, in our society, our institutions are under pressure to sell tickets, to prove themselves economically. Well, we can't. Every classical music, every opera theater, every symphony orchestra loses money. So therefore, somebody has got to support it. Now, we do not live in a country where the government really completely supports the arts. What happened in Europe was as the aristocracy gradually disappeared, as kings, queens, dukes gradually disappeared during the 19th century, and there was the new middle class, it became this all passed to entrepreneurship. But in the 20th century, the government took over the function of those sponsors, and government has supported the arts. Now, I've lived in Europe for 20 years, been conducting there for 30 years. I have been intimately and deeply involved in what it means to have government support for the arts. And I can also tell you that it's not paradise. There are many problems with that. And I can also tell you that the American system isn't as bad. I have to give a nuanced answer. The government does support the arts in certain ways by having nonprofit organizations who don't pay, who don't have to pay out taxes. And that's a form of subsidy. The fact is that contributions to nonprofit organizations by individuals is a form of tax deduction. That is a form of sponsorship. But what we don't have in America is a powerful voice to emphasize and help arts education from the government. I believe that our government has let us down terribly within my lifetime. Now, I'm thinking to the changes in the 1980s, and most of you who are in school now, of course, have grown up in an era where you may not know what you'd missed. I'm, you know, old enough now to remember in my youth, we had lots of orchestras and bands. Everybody got to play at least a tonette, if not, as I did, a violin or play the trumpet, or there was band. Music education, classical music education, was a regular part of our schools. And through political decisions made in the 1980s, it was abandoned, and basically on a market-orientated, let the market decide, get big government out of this, let individuals decide. But it was a decision that left far too much to chance. So I've scribbled down just some quick ideas and thoughts to you to leave them with you, and then I'll open it up to your questions. And one of the questions I want to pose is that, to what degree does the market-oriented value system, which we are, of course, the greatest example in the world, for better and for worse, and I think in many respects we're all experiencing the negative part of that in these weeks, and to what degree is it are byproducts of democracy also playing a role in inhibiting serious art and classical art? And I also now will include contemporary art, contemporary literature, the seriousness of contemporary writing and how important it is for society and how we may be compromising it. There is an apparent contradiction in our society. Easy and quick accessibility is a byproduct of democracy. In other words, if something is not easily accessible or understood, it tends to fall by the wayside. Okay? Important element in serious literature, music, dance, art. It is the difficulty of working in an environment of sound bites and photo ops, the triumph of image over content. A photo is worth a thousand words, has made it difficult for people to differentiate between content and surface. Okay. At one extreme, the New York Times, which is still a newspaper where you can read about something at least for several paragraphs or several pages, with the marketable and perhaps very profitable USA Today, where it was decided that nobody would read more than a paragraph or two, and they wanted the whole story encapsulated in two paragraphs. That makes it hard for people, I believe, to listen to Wagner operas. if you can only deal with a paragraph with your coffee in the morning, it's very hard to get somebody to sit seriously for a long time. The overriding ascendancy of the advertising and marketing industry, whose success is measured in selling a product based on a variety of techniques which inspire a purchase or gut instinct, but not knowledge, and with a slow and insidious effect of being unable to distinguish, at least at the beginning, between the packaging and the value of the product. Big problem when you go to a young person who's never heard a Mozart symphony and you can't package it well enough to get that person to go and listen to a Mozart symphony. The gradual shortening of the attention span of our society through the explosion of television viewing since World War II, that a program can only be of a certain length, interrupted constantly by advertisement. Very hard to get people to sit still. The general pace of life and sharing of information, which has affected our ability to sit quietly, a prerequisite for sustained listening, contemplation of the graphic arts, or reading a great novel. The loss to the arts of political crossfire from both left and right. This includes the loss of the status in the 1980s, the cutting of funds to which I referred, for almost all of those activities. Let the market decide if schools and parents wanted to pursue this for their children. Completely overlooking the enormous power that conformity plays in young people's natural desire to be accepted and liked by everybody else. In other words, I certainly suffered. I was a nerd very early on and suffered terribly. I had thick glasses. I was 13 years old and went and announced rather naively to my friends in junior high school that I loved opera. Big mistake. I was humiliated. They kicked sand in my face. They made fun of me. All of it. There are many, many bad epithets. But I was a weirdo, and I suffered because I loved something, and nobody seemed to think that was a good thing to love. But I must thank the High School of Music and Art in New York, which some of you will know from Fame, the movie, which was a very big exaggeration of what it was like. But in my first week, the relief that I experienced from knowing that there were at least 2,000 other kids who loved the same things that I loved. Okay, kids want to be accepted, and I certainly know from my vantage point of those thick glasses that when everybody isn't doing it, it's very hard to get anybody to do it, because of peer pressure and how difficult. And unfortunately, the best years are lost. The capacity of young children to absorb, I definitely believe in the werewolf experience. Put out any infants in the forest, feed them, nurture them, love them, mother them, and play Bach and Brahms. They will whistle Bach and Brahms at the end of 4 years, and they will be able, that for them will be music. So the disappearance of classical music radio stations across the country is a very serious, because we learn to love music by osmosis. Everybody does not have to be a practicing professional musician. But there is no reason that everybody can't love classical music or be exposed to the arts. And, you know, I'm ashamed to tell you, but I will. I had Classics Illustrated comic books when I was 6 and 7 years old. I mean, that's my first experience of Charles Dickens was classic comic books. I would love to see them come back, at least because people would have some idea of literature, which is now becoming, have been passing up. In recent years, well, the idea is 60s and 70s that art and much else must be relevant and prove its relevance to our contemporary terms. I posit that art, and great classical art, is something that does not have to explain itself on anybody else's terms or anything else's terms, that the art has a value in itself, and that is the reason that it has a magnetism, because people have come back to it, hundreds of years after its creation. In recent years, branding as elite or elitist from both the right side and the left side of the political spectrum, without carefully defining the terms of elite and what is elitist, or nor seriously discussing these in terms of making value judgments. The overwhelming arbitration of the effect of the box office. The bottom line, responsible economics, sellability, ability to make money, which is, of course, almost unheard of in the history of classical music and serious arts. The historic tradition of relegating support of the arts largely, although not completely, to the private sector, which I've touched on. The bottom line mentality, which overlooks that the arts have always historically been patronized, and I've touched on that. The bottom line is that when the most powerful elements in society do not support the arts, the practice and enjoyment of those arts, it benefits, suffers, and I believe our society suffers, because the things that we learn from classical art are not the same things that we learn in our everyday lives and mundane. And I think that in many cases, our country is suffering now, even though it has been a superpower and has been in many, many respects the beacon of the 20th century and has a great history for which it has been proud. I believe we have lost our way in many respects, but I believe a part of that is the turning away from seriousness in literature, seriousness in music, and not viewing everything as entertainment. The entertainment industry, and God help me to be able to say this in Los Angeles, a few miles away from Hollywood, the entertainment industry, which of course is one of our greatest accomplishments, has also brought with it a price, and that is that now our general public, I'm talking about the great populace, cannot differentiate or cannot deal with something that is quote-unquote not entertaining. Don't forget, Shakespeare was entertainment, but he was also much more than entertainment. That operas are entertaining and can be entertaining, but they're much more than entertainment. So in a society where market value and financial advancement are a supreme value, the arts suffer, even though there is no inherent contradiction between market values and financial advancement. And finally, the effects of the echo chamber, the continued repetition of our societal and cultural values, articulated or not, have contributed to the narrowing of our consciousness of the values of cultures distant in time and place. And that is to say, the very sphere where classical takes on its meaning. So, echo chamber, do we want to see ourselves reflected day in and day out on the stage, in the books we read, in the paintings or the art which we look at? Do we need to see ourselves reflected, and do we need to feel every day that we are reaffirming ourselves by seeing a replica of ourselves? Or should art be, as classical art ensures, a confrontation with other minds, other societies, other aspects of our civilization, mentalities which are no longer modern but can challenge what we are today, and in fact, in my opinion, must challenge what we are today, because when we only look at ourselves, we are narcissists, and this is the biggest danger, I believe, to our society, because we are a great and a powerful nation, but we are playing into our own greatest weakness, which is to look at ourselves as the center of this planet and the center of this universe. And I believe that classical arts is a very small but a very important part of challenging that view of ourselves as the center of the universe. Galileo took care of that many, many centuries ago, and it is something that every society needs to remember. So these are, in my opinion, subtle questions that I think we have to look into. I may be wrong about all of them, but I would love to be contradicted by any of you. I would love you, however, to go away and think about them, and think about, are there solutions? Is it true what I'm saying? Is it a problem? And what do we need to do to address that? And you, so many of you young people, will play a much more important role than I will, because you will have the energy and the future in which to do that and to confront it. That's my speech. Thank you very much. I will open you to questions. I have to wave goodbye to my beautiful wife and my beautiful daughter who's flying back to New York on the red eye, and thank you for coming, and thank them very much for coming. Okay, I'm open to your questions, and I'll stay as long as you will. I always overstay my welcome, so ask as many questions as you like, and I'm here to answer them. And I think there's some microphones there in the hall. There. And don't be shy. There you are. You can just shout at me. I won't take it personally.
Okay, I can
Yeah.
So do you have for many of us here in this room that are future performers, audience members, educators, how do we fight against these very powerful forces of the media and the lack of funding and the constant having to meet that bottom line, the having to make money? How do we face those problems?
Okay, the question is how do you and the younger generation, how do you face the challenges? How do you fight against these tendencies, if I'm understanding correctly your question? Yeah. Okay, start by inspiring yourself with the story of David and Goliath. Remember that the pen is mightier than the sword. That, first of all, your consciousness of these questions, and you are bringing that consciousness to other people's, is your greatest instrument, your greatest weapon, if you want to use that word. That, first of all, it needs to be discussed, it needs to be disseminated. If you find the subject interesting and the questions interesting, start by talking about them tonight, and talk about them tomorrow. Ask your friends, do these questions interest you? Do you think that this is true? And then research it, speak about it. If you are a performing artist, I have chosen in the course of my lifetime, and also pretty much against my personality, to start to speak from the stage at concerts. Here I am. This is a public speech tonight. This is not something I would have considered, even thought about doing 15 years ago. For various reasons, I just didn't think it was appropriate for artists to speak. But I've now come to the conclusion that if artists don't get out there from their ivory tower, and if we don't do it, we can't count on anybody else to do it. I do not believe that the arts institutions or the artists themselves are primarily responsible for the fact that we are fighting for a place in our society, or even the institutions are fighting for money. I don't think that we are responsible for the problem. I do think we have played a role, and we have to correct that role. But if we don't get out there and fight, those of us who live for this art form, who's going to do it? I mean, you know, when I was growing up, the best way to make an impression on anybody was to act as if you were a genius. And, you know, you didn't talk to anybody, you put your nose in the air, you made yourself look as weird as possible so that somebody would think you were Beethoven. You believed your mother who thought you were a genius, you know, and so you met letter. Okay, that was it. Don't be accessible, be inaccessible, be out of it. Make people think that you were, God's gift to humanity. Well, this, I think, has been very damaging to classical music. I think it's very important for us who are on the stage to also get out there and passionately speak for the importance of these issues. And I'd like to also say that there's an extraordinary paradox. I call it the American paradox. In my lifetime, the growth in classical music has been unparalleled in our history. There are probably more great symphony orchestras in America than any other country in the world. Will that be forever? That I don't know, but it is true now. When I was a young boy, there were three major opera companies in America. One of them was not Los Angeles Opera, which is the youngest and the fastest growing opera company. Has become large in 20 years, which is very fast. There were three: New York, San Francisco, and Chicago was just born when I was a little boy. Now there are regional opera companies everywhere. There are more string quartets in residence and universities than at any time in our history. So, good news? All of it's good news. What's the paradox? I don't know a single arts institution that is not fighting to keep its audience. Paradox. It has to be looked into. You can help us answer those questions. Are the schools doing enough? Are the universities doing enough? Are the nursery schools doing enough? And that's where I think that has what has to be targeted. What's wrong with having 4-year-olds learn about classical arts on a level that is proper for them? Are the churches doing enough? Are the religious institutions doing enough? If you are a religious person and you believe in God's creation, it seems to me that those wonderful products of that creation are music, are art, are literature, and all those wonderful things. Are the churches doing enough? I don't think the churches are doing enough. I don't think the universities are doing enough, but I most of all don't feel that primary education, that between the ages of 5 and 16, are doing anything near, because those are the formative years. The idea that it's elitist or for elite people, I am totally against it. I am not elite by any anybody's term. I grew up in New York from a lower middle class family that did not have the means to provide me with a who loved me and wanted me to do whatever I wanted. I've got two brothers and sisters. None of them are musicians. My parents weren't musicians. My grandparents weren't musicians. But I chose music, or music chose me, and without any means, I managed, because I lived in New York City, which is probably the biggest blessing of my life, because you could go out and get it if you were determined. But I'm nobody's elite. I wasn't the most talented person in school by a long range. But if you want something and it means that much to you, you can, in this wonderful country, pursue it and accomplish something. But there are hundreds of people. Do you know that the most extraordinary country in the Western world that produces more great, and Los Angeles is the place to appreciate that, Esa-Pekka Salonen, my colleague, whom I admire and whom I love, comes from a country so small that you could fit it in most states in our country, has more great musicians coming out. Why? Because the entire population is educated, and so of course the greatly talented are going to come right up to the top very quickly. But the entire population is that, and you are about to start in Los Angeles. Gustavo Dudamel, who's the superstar of the classical music world now, comes from a system where thousands upon thousands of young Venezuelans are exposed to classical music. Shouldn't America wake up and see that? I mean, how can it be that countries that we have nothing against these countries, but we like to view ourselves as superior. How have we let this happen in our country? I'm not saying everybody has to be a classical musician, but I am saying that every child should be exposed to classical music. And I include, of course, ballet, literature, Charles Dickens, whether in classics, illustrated comic books or not. We should. That is. Those are the primary years and the most important. Yes. You just shout it out. And
why is it that today, I'm talking about the United States, I don't know about much internationally, but why is it that today we don't see a lot of French opera being performed, like Lalo and Massenet, aside from Manon and Gounod and any other, Alavi? Why don't we see these composers and their operas being performed? Is there something historically in society that makes it difficult for these operas to be performed?
Okay, good question. The question is, the French operas of most of the 19th century, which are not performed, thinking of Lalo, Alévi, maybe you're thinking of Massenet aside from Manon, why are French operas not so, I guess, so popular? Okay, I'm a good person to ask, and I'm not a good person to ask. I'm a good person to ask because, of course, I spent 9 wonderful years as music director of the Paris Opera. And you know the naivete sometimes in America, somebody actually seriously asked me, do you only do French opera at the Paris Opera, and are all operas in French? I said, you know that Paris is a capital of the world, not just one of the world's greatest cities, but one with a tradition in the arts that goes back centuries, long before the United States was even heard of. And it's an international opera house, and no, we don't only do French opera, and no, we do operas in their original language, as every other thing. However, that being said, I loved certain aspects of French music profoundly. And I myself have a problem with a lot of 19th century French opera. And so I ask myself, is it something that has been eliminated because of, or not eliminated, but has not found a constituency in today's world? Is it because of inherent weakness in the form? Or is it because of suppression or not? It's not suppression. It has been exposed to the test of time. My defense of the suppressed composers is that they have not been allowed to have their time in public to either to survive or not to survive, that it's been an artificial suppression, a political suppression. Alevi, Maiber, Lalo, even Massenet, my taste in French music goes further to Debussy, to Ravel. I think Pelléas and Mélisande is one of the greatest works of art, period. That's my impressionism, or the so-called impressionist composers are that's my cup of tea. I happen to love Chausson. I happen to like Lalo very much. But I do think there was a fundamental problem in French opera. French opera was deeply committed, or shouldn't say committed, was deeply tied to a tradition of a certain type of theater and spectacle. And this was what made it popular, particularly with the middle class, but may have condemned itself to have made fundamental compromises with being popular. In other words, maybe they made the same mistake that serious art has made in America. That, okay, well, I can't make it with my serious art. I'm going to try to move on to something that's sellable. I think that that may be part of the problem. But you know what? There are people. I love a lot of Massenet's music. Alevi, certainly La Juive is a very, very extraordinary work. Some of the music of Lalo is very, very important. But I'm speaking, of course, from my own point of view and prejudice. That I think that there are things that fundamentally compromised a lot of French opera, even though there's some marvelous music. I mean, Carmen, of course, is a masterpiece out of every possible comparison. And remember, it was a failure, and remember, he was not a success. And he died unhappy in his 40s, a very young man.
First of all, to preface this, I was not a child in America. I didn't grow up in the American musical environment. And one of the things I remember when I moved to L.A. is I thought that L.A. was devoid of culture.
I'm an Easterner, and that's all we heard. Yeah, here I am, as happy as a lark.
And one of the things I think that L.A. particularly is underestimated in the amount of cultural richness that exists here. And sometimes, while I was listening to you speak, I was thinking, is it possibly because we're in the midst of this change, like with what you're doing with LA Opera, and with what Salonen and Dudamel will probably do with the LA Phil and all of the other organizations, you know, Monday Evening Concerts, etc., which have started in LA. Do you think that sometimes we can't actually see what's happening because we're right in the midst of it at this stage?
You mean that you, as a person from Los Angeles, appreciate what...
Yeah, that somehow L.A. doesn't get its worthwhileness, that we can't see it yet because it's not... We don't have the hindsight for it yet?
Well, either that or you're not outside of it. I mean, somehow you don't see Los Angeles in its context.
Sure.
Is that the question? Oh, I sort of lost you at the end.
I think I did as well. No, it's just basically that I think because we're in the midst of this great cultural change and this regeneration or re-support of the arts, like what you said you were doing with the Birds Opera, with LA Opera, and what Salonen did with Finnish music in LA, and all of like Green Umbrella, etc., that it is actually progressing forward here, even though it might not be in other parts of the country.
Well, frankly, I think Los Angeles is very innovative and is very open, and I'm enjoying it now. You know, California played no role in most of my life. Oddly enough, I conducted in the Bowl in the 70s as a, you know, the latest young thing on the street. You know, the flavor of that particular month or so, and did not appear in Los Angeles between 1980 and 2002. I literally did not conduct the Los Angeles Philharmonic for 22 years. Now I guess conduct very happily with Los Angeles Philharmonic. I last conducted the San Francisco Symphony in 1980. I returned 2 years ago for the first time in 25 years. California played no role. I grew up in the East Coast. I grew up in New York. And then I spent most of my adult life more in Europe than in the United States. So California was to me a little bit like that New Yorker magazine. I'm sure you've seen it. If you haven't, don't look. that I now am in love with what I see in Los Angeles. It was a fluke. Placido Domingo called me up at a moment that I happened to be leaving my jobs in Europe, and I said I just got rid of two enormous jobs and was looking to goofing off a little bit goofing off means for me working, I guess, 10 months instead of 12 and a half. But he got me at the right moment, and he talked me into it. I was really not, I said, really? I came out, I'm very happy, and I'm so happy now. First of all, I love my opera company, I love my orchestra, I love the atmosphere in LA Opera. I love the public, I love being able to do things like what I'm doing tonight. I love being able to talk about art. I give a introductory talk every night before I conduct, an hour before. And if you like to come, if you've been, come again. If you haven't been, come. You get it's in there for the price of your ticket. There's no extra cost to it. I love being able to do that. And I don't think I would be able to do that in most cities to the degree. I see the figures of how many people come to those talks before the conference. We have more than half the audience there. I see the figures every night. That is something to be really appreciated. I think people in Los Angeles really are interested in we can be innovative, and we are. Los Angeles has a lot to be proud of, and it just should keep going doing what it's doing. So if that's the question, that's the answer. Okay.
Hello. The question is, do you think that there's some tension between the Jewish community and the music of Wagner? And if there is, how long do you think it will take for the Jewish community to better appreciate his music?
Okay, this is a great question.
Actually, that was the first question.
Sorry?
I have a second one. So.
Well, I will actually, I am sure, sometime in the course of the next 12 months, give a talk on that subject. The subject is basically, I announced my first press conference when I came to Los Angeles Opera. There are two basic pillars of what I want to do here with the repertoire. And I said this to Placido Domingo. I said, look, I'll come and conduct all the Verdi and Puccini and Mozart you want, because that's what a music director does. There are two things, though, that have to become a part of our future, and a stable part. Wagner, and my recovered voices, which I introduced to him. And first question I got, press conference, says, how can you love all that music of Jewish composers suppressed by the Nazis and love Richard Wagner at the same time and believe in the importance of both? And I said, I can talk for 5 hours on that subject. And the reason, first of all, is most of those composers, some of whom died in concentration camps, absolutely adored Richard Wagner, who were, not to say that they admired him would be understatements. Richard Wagner left an imprint on music, on theater, on poetry, unparalleled in the history of classical music. Plenty of classical music composers have left extraordinary classical music, but nobody has had the revolutionizing effect, including the rejection and the reaction to his innovations, as Richard Wagner. Arnold Schoenberg idolized Wagner. Mahler idolized Wagner. Zemlinsky, Schreker, you go down the line, they idolized Wagner, and they were all Jewish. So, it was not an issue. It was not an issue to even those composers who, at the time that they were being suppressed, it was not an issue to them that Richard Wagner had been a horrible anti-Semite. His humanity is not to be defended on, not just on account of his anti-Semitism, of his total egoism, his megalomania. And I would say that if you would probably have to look at him as a man who also was extremely deranged mentally in many respects, paranoiac, narcissistic to a degree that was, I guess, paralleled his great genius. So, but is it the art or is it the artist? Is it the composition or the composer? The fact is that if we were to subject other composers to the spotlight of looking into their humanity, we would discover something that is an unpleasant thing for what we like to think. We like to think in our times everybody's a nice and lovely human being, and nice and lovely human beings make great art, and a bad human being can't make good art, and well, a good human being can make bad art. the obverse does not work. The fact is, though, that we do not understand the nature of genius. And that part of the mystery of genius is that it surpasses the human frailties of the individual. In other words, a human being with all of our flaws is capable of creating art that goes way beyond the individual. That I defy anybody to explain that, because we don't really have an explanation for that. If you were to submit Da Vinci, Caravaggio to the scrutiny of their human lives, I think you'd be very disappointed. If you looked into the attitudes of many of the composers and artists, or their lives, their personal lives, their political lives, their philosophical lives, they, along with, by the way, most of us that you see on stage, you might be really disappointed if you really knew me. You know what? You might not find everything so wonderful about me. I mean, certainly my wife and kids tell me about, a lot of things. So, none of us are so. We are. W.H. Auden wrote words. I'm going to paraphrase them because I don't remember exactly. He said, "Don't look at our lives, look at our works. Our works are so much better than our lives." Said by one of the great writers of the 20th century. Great poets and great writers and great thinkers, in my opinion. Now, that the story of Richard Wagner, the human being, is one. The story of you, of Richard Wagner, the artist, and his legacy to art is another. The story of the abuse and the hijacking on the part of Adolf Hitler and the Nazis of Wagner's music is just that. It was theft. That there is any question that, first of all, Wagner couldn't have been a Nazi. He died before Hitler was born. The nationalism that was espoused by Wagner, if it is understood in the terms of the time, was not imperialism. The crimes of Adolf Hitler and the Nazis were imperialism, that they wanted to take a nation and make that nation dominate the world through violence. The nationalism of Richard Wagner was thought of in the context of a still ununified Germany, which was a collection of city-states, of dukes and kings, and what he was, and also, by the way, foreign influences. I mean, there was an enormous French influence on the level of the ruling powers. French still fighting between Catholic and Reformation. Germany was not unified in any sense, but what he was saying is, there is, however, a German language, and there is a German culture, and that German culture should be sacred to us, and it should be fostered. Well, I don't disagree with that. And by the way, Mussorgsky was doing the same thing in Russia. Smetana and Dvořák were doing the same thing in Czech, what is now the Czech Republic. Verdi was doing, in his way, the same thing in Italy. The French were doing it. He was not doing anything any differently from what was the tenor of the times. These are many, 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 many questions that have to be looked into, this fascinating question about the 20th century abuse of Wagner and the contrast between the human being and the genius. And I advocate the suppressed composers. I advocate them all. I'm not Jewish, but I advocate all of them, and I advocate them being performed side by side for Wagner, because that is the tradition in which they were written, and that is where they belong. In fact, we do them a disservice if we don't put them right up there with all those other composers, because that's where I believe they belong.
And my second question is, what do you think has to be done for minorities to appreciate or even think about pursuing a career in music? Because I know that when I went to my parents like 2 years ago, they were like, ¿qué? Like, what are you going to do with that? So what do you think has to, or what do you think I, as a minority, have to do, or what do you think we have to do in general?
First of all, I think you should do what wherever your passion leads you, that's where you should go in life. That's whether it's music, whether it's sports, whether it's art, whether it's teaching, whether it's Wall Street. I mean, go there. Your passion should be your guide. I fell in love passionately with classical music at the age of 11. I don't know why, but it happened at 11 years old. And I can tell you that I do not feel one bit different today, many decades, more decades than I care to think about.
I don't feel one bit different from the way I did then. I love every day. It leaves me, like most passions, you never have enough of it. It doesn't leave you in peace any day. That's the price you pay. I love it. But I love to go to work. I get paid to do, don't tell this to my boss, what I would do for free if I had to. Because I love it that much, and I know that I, at the end of my life, I will feel that I didn't have enough time to spend with all the things that I love. And it's not just music, I love a lot of other things too. But passion is, to me, the indication of where your path is. Passion's got an awfully bad rap in a lot of ways in our moralistic society. To me, there is no human force stronger than passion. And hopefully, when it's attached to a worthwhile goal, it's the greatest motivator. So I would be led by that, and it doesn't matter. Sister Wolf, for me, there are no minorities and majorities, there are human beings. And you should not ever put a tag on yourself and say, well, how can I do this? Look, I want to tell you something. There's nothing worse than, I live in a rarefied profession. There's, I don't know how many international conductors, okay, you can count to 100, 200, I don't know how many we are, you know, sort of up there. I can't think of anything worse than being an American. I can't think of anything worse than being an American in Europe. I can't think of anything worse than being an American in America. You know, somebody once told me very early in my 20s, there's the two things to remember about being an American conductor. This, by the man, was a man who was the father of one of my school chums who was a lawyer. He was still alive in his late 90s, and his son lives here in LA. We see each other now all the time. He said, don't forget two things. When it comes to classical music and being a conductor, he said, Americans prefer Europeans, and Europeans prefer Europeans. Number one. And number two, you will have to work twice as hard to get half as far. Two wiser things have never been said to me. They were said to me, I was about 26 or 27 years old. I had already intuited it, and I will say decades later, nothing's changed. That is absolutely the way it is. But you know what? I didn't go in this to get far. And sure, I don't like prejudice and or people's viewing me as a stereotype, but the fact is, I do what I love. I get up every day and I am doing the thing that I love the most. And if some Europeans don't prefer me, that's fine. There's a big world out there and you can still do what you want. And if Americans still haven't really gotten over the fact that, yes, there are great American artists and we have something to say as well, and it's not necessarily less than something else, it's just different. Till we really get a consciousness of our own value, which we still don't have in that respect, then there'll be certain prejudices and stereotypes. But so what? The little injustices that I suffer are so small compared to the deep injustices that people of all races and all nations have been subjected to and are still subjected to in our world, that there's a gift in this to me, and the gift is it reminds me not to forget how important injustice is and how those of us who are really lucky, like I'm really lucky to be doing what I love doing, should not forget about those people, many people, millions of people who suffer injustice every day in the world.
Maestro, I have a I'm up here, over here. Hi. A very basic, but I think important question that impacts everybody here. We sort of take it for granted the importance of classical arts because that's what the majority of the audience is involved in. But obviously, the majority of the American public doesn't get it. The lack of classical arts in schools from ages 5 to 16 is really the fault of the American public because they put the pressure on the lawmakers and the curriculum makers, and it doesn't seem to have any importance. For us to sort of have a mission statement or a talking point, for us to express the importance of this to people that have to be sold the idea, what is the intrinsic value of classical arts for those people who don't believe that it has that value? How do we define that in a way that would fit in USA today, something that could be easily digestible and really succinct and comprehensible. What's the intrinsic value of the classical arts? Why do we need them?
Okay, this is a great question, and I think this is going to be my next lecture because I know I'm overstaying my welcome. The answer is it's an enormous job, I think, what we have in front of us. First of all, you ask what are the intrinsic values of art that need to be made clear to others, or in a certain way, the utility of the art. First part of that is the art itself does not have to prove itself to anybody or anything. In fact, part of the characteristic of those arts, I believe, is that they are a value in and unto themselves. But it's like a tree falling in the forest. If nobody's looking at those pictures, if nobody is going off to see the Mona Lisa, and not because they read the Da Vinci Code, but because they want to see that, you know, that's interesting to them, or they don't listen to a Beethoven symphony, or they don't go to the Sistine Chapel, or they're not reading Shakespeare, how do you tell them it's important? There used to be a question that was, well, are the arts relevant? That was the crisis. You know, also classical music, is it relevant in our time? Well, the crisis now isn't to ask if it's relevant. First of all, how can music be not relevant? Music itself, a Beethoven sonata couldn't care less whether you or I find it relevant. The Beethoven sonata is the Beethoven sonata, and it has a value of its own, which surpasses any individual judgments. But the problem is, how do you tell? There's no discussion now. The discussion has disappeared. It's not even, are the arts relevant? There are people who don't even know what they are. And the problem is, it's not that we're elite or we're better. We're just lucky. We are the lucky ones because we have somehow or other have that the arts have touched our lives. I think that the danger to our, I believe our country is in a perilous moment because we are sleepwalking at the moment and have been. I've lived outside of the country for 20 years. One of the most upsetting things to me, well, deeply upsetting, horrible things that has happened is the loss of American credibility in the world in the last, since 9/11. A terrible attack, unjustified and unjustifiable, could have, should have brought the Western world, not just the Western world, the world together to, and we could have done this, and we didn't. We did the opposite. America has lost its credibility in the eyes of the world. Now, we may think we can do it all ourselves. We cannot. No power at any time in history has been able to do it all by itself. The Roman Empire fell of its own weight. And we cannot continue to play a major role in the world when everybody feels the way they do about our country. Everybody. We can do without some. You know, I was in France when it all happened, and I certainly am critical. I lived in France. I have been traveling to France for 30 years. I have worked in France for 28 years, and I lived there, was a French resident, and had responsibility for the largest classical, well, the largest actually, along with the Louvre, the Paris Opera, is the most expensive and important cultural institution in France. I proudly wear this little red thing here, which is not something that you just scratch and say you've got something on your collar. But that's the Legion of Honor, which I was given by Jacques Chirac personally. I am proud of that, and I wear it now. I'm not a particularly proud person, but I wear it, and I wear it almost out of defiance, because I was there when in the most critical time after 9/11. And I hated seeing the beating that the French were taking because they simply disagreed with us. And unfortunately, I thought at the time, well, we can do without the French. And I am very critical of French politics because I've seen it from the inside. But I was very, I said, well, you know, America can do it without the French. And then I said, well, America can do it without Western Europe. And, well, you know, America, well, you know what? America can't do without Western Europe and Russia and China and Japan and most of Africa and a great deal of the Middle East and India. America cannot do it by itself. And yet we still have people sleepwalking through that fact. Now, what does this have to do with cultural? What does this have to do with literature? What does this have to do with the arts? I think it has a lot to do with the arts. And I'm going to bring something out of my memory, and I believe it was a statement by Charles de Gaulle, which was applied to a certain historic moment in our own history by Henry Kissinger. The statement was, Americans do not have a sense of the tragic, and that is why we failed in Vietnam. What was meant by that? What was meant by that is that everybody who grew up in Greece knows what a tragedy was to the Greeks. A tragedy is when somebody or something great falls by its own, by the contradictions or the Achilles heel, a Greek term, by that fatal flaw, by hubris, which was always one way or the other, defying the gods when you were out of your depths. And what happened? Then there's a tragedy. Now, the older cultures, Europe, the Middle East, the Far East, all have a sense of the tragic. America has been made great with its optimism, and that is a great thing. It's not to be undervalued. Our belief that you can do something, that you can make a difference, that there is a world to be constructed, that these are the things, these are the dynamos that created the greatness of our country. But, as in all things, there's another side of that. Excessive optimism, inability to look into the mirror, is a societal weakness, and I believe it is a major societal weakness for us. Now, why the classical arts? I think that if you have read one Dostoevsky novel or one Shakespeare play from beginning to end, if you've read just a little bit of Goethe, I'm just picking names out, it's quite different from reading about, I don't know, a whodunit in your own city, the city of your choice here in the U.S., or watching Dallas on the television, or, you know, there's a big difference because you start to get wisdom. Classical arts expand your brain, they expand your emotional capacity, they challenge you, and the other thing that's classical about them is you've heard that symphony once, it's not enough. You want to go back to it a second time. You want to go back a second time, you want to go back a tenth time. There are pieces I've conducted 50, 100 times. I keep going back to them. That's what makes it classical. That means that there is a bottomless well there to be written. Now, there's a big difference between the insight, the expansion of one's humanity, one's capacities, one's intellectual capacities, one's emotional capacities, our ability to empathize through dealing with the tragic. That's why I love opera. You know, somebody once called it the extravagant art. You get up there, someone's dying of love, literally. All right? There's jealousy, there's passion. There is death at the end of it. There, you know, I mean, the soprano dies in most operas, you know, or the tenor, or both of them, or all of them. You know, I deal every day in ultimate emotions. We don't, you know, it's not about, you know, it's not about selling a product. It's not about get through the day so that you can go have dinner. We deal with big emotions day and night. Well, for me, it's all out there. So the big questions are out there every day of my life in a very real way through arts. Now, that's not different for a graphic artist. That's not different for somebody who puts themselves in dance. Now, I'm not saying the arts have a monopoly on this, but what I'm saying is that these arts expand your mercilessly expand your humanity. You're going to cry more, you're going to laugh more, you're going to see ironies, you're going to see paradoxes, you're going to see subtleties. I have been amazed in my travels to go into tiny, poor
villages in the south of Italy. Now, I happen to be a quarter of Italian, and my soul is Italian, so, okay, I'm prejudiced. I think Italy, I think the Italians created everything. They created music, they created art, they created notation, they made the first instruments, they made the Renaissance. I mean, they really, it's the most creatively created country in Western Europe, certainly. Okay, I love them. All right, I go into a small, tiny village, and inevitably end up in a, you know, I make myself end up in some little, you know, have a coffee and get talking. I talk to local people. I used to travel around the trains when I was a young man. I would always talk to everybody I could talk to. What did I find? That people, those people, haven't been to universities, they have an insight into life which is so strikingly different from anything that I knew. And I grew up in the world's biggest city in the world, New York City, with everything that was a new city. I was finding things in little towns in Italy, in the country, in France. I found that my travels brought me. I went to Czechoslovakia when it was still behind the Iron Curtain. Experienced all of these. It is amazing to me how much wisdom is to be found in what we euphemistically call simple people. They have been to universities. They're not wealthy enough. The wisdom of the older older civilizations is much greater than the wisdom or the lack of wisdom of our society. I'm not saying that we have some of those brilliant people in the world. We have the means with which to produce in our countries. And yet our populace is less wise, in my opinion, this is my opinion, you can argue with it, is less wise than that of older cultures. And I feel our only access to that, unless you can travel, our only access is going to be through literature and through art. I remember talking with a friend of mine from the Middle East at the beginning of the falling apart of the situation in Iraq after the initial, euphemistically called victory in 5 days or 10 days, or 3 weeks, said, when it fell apart, my friend who comes from that part of the world said, any 10-year-old in Iraq could have told you this was happening. Any 10-year-old. Why? Because they know the environment. And because there are certain, you know, the Russians have an expression, a bad peace is better than a good war. That is something to say. I mean, this is the kind of, we have our own folk wisdom, but somehow to me, it's not dealing on the same level, and I think that it's not going to, as long as entertainment is the ultimate activity. First of all, making money is the first activity, and second is being entertained. Somebody wrote a book, I know the title, I haven't read the book, but the title fascinates me, Amusing Ourselves to Death. Very provocative title. I haven't got the book yet, but the title, that's the entertainment. I once asked a very wise old man whom I respected very much, I said, what do you think are the two greatest societal, or the greatest societal ill in America? He was American, of course, very old man. Said, without hesitating, didn't even have to take time to inhale, he said, greed. He said, and now, and he meant within the last 10, 15 years, addiction to excitement. Addiction to excitement, that's worth thinking about. Because I think that part of that is the problem with, you know, you say, how do we get to other people? The problem with getting them into an opera house or to listen to a Mahler symphony or to sit through a Wagner opera is, I think there's nothing more exciting than a Mahler symphony or a Wagner opera. To me, that's the height of excitement. But how do you get a person to sit still who is not able to meditate? Now, you know that we have some fantastic traditions now of meditation. We have meditation centers. We have people going off to spas where they're going to meditate. That's fantastic. But why can't we meditate more within the context of our everyday lives? You don't have the opportunity to sit or, you know, to go away. You can do yoga every day. You can meditate every day. But sometimes you just can't. Well, there's got to be ways of inner meditation, and there are. But to me, art and the I hate the word consumption of art, and I think rightfully so. It should be hated. But art is viewed as entertainment and consumed. It's viewed as a consumer product. Have you ever heard the expression, I'm going to New York, I'm going to Broadway, I'm going to take in a play, as if you were eating a cake? You know, the fact is that listening to a symphony, listening to a Chopin piano recital, sitting in the Louvre, that's meditation too. Spending time with an author who was, let's say, writing in Russia 200 years ago, or in Elizabethan, is a form of meditation. These are all forms of meditation. I think that arts are, in a way, probably an easier form of meditation. But if you have a populace whose concentration has been diminished by television, whose grandmothers already were addicted to, you know why? One of the reasons I was a nerd as a child and had thick glasses. I had thick glasses because we were all myopic in my family. But I was a nerd because my crazy mother thought that television was a total waste of time and refused to have a television in the house. And because my father was an avid reader, he didn't care because he read every day of his life. So we didn't have a television. Well, did I feel weird? You bet I felt weird. Did I feel resentful? I felt resentful until I decided, well, I guess I shouldn't feel resentful. I should feel superior. So for a few years, I felt superior. But way down deep, I felt inferior and left out. You know, today, if I could bring my parents back from the dead and thank them for anything, there is nothing I would thank them more for than not having a television in my house. And it made me weird and it made me different, but it also informed my passion because I started reading like that at that age. And I already, all I could dream about when I was 8 years old, before I fell in love with classical music, was traveling. And I wanted to go see Russia, and I wanted to go see France. I wanted to see ancient Rome, as if you could see it. You know, I wanted to see, that's what I wanted to do. And that's all thanks to arts in their different ways. By the time I was 11, then it was all clear to me that every child could have that, and every child should have that. And that's where I think we are seriously compromised, because in the political arena, we have a culture of ignorance, and if it were just the arts, I'd be happy. We have a culture of ignorance in politics that expands to not even knowing about the rest of the world. I am humiliated when I see friends of mine in Europe who can literally close their eyes and reproduce the map of the world. And that's, you know what? I mean, geography. Do you all know which countries border on which and which is east and west in the entire world? I mean, kids grow up with that. There's an awareness that there is something else than yourself. And we are very much stuck in, we're not bad people. We're not, you know, Europeans, people in eastern countries consider us arrogant. I actually don't think that Americans are arrogant. I think, in fact, I do certainly know as an American, I have experienced a lot of Europeans as being arrogant. I happen to love Europe profoundly, and I live with it, but I do consider there's a lot of arrogant people. A lot of people feel superior. Americans don't generally strike me as being arrogant, and yet our politics are arrogant. Our politics are arrogant because our politics are really provincial. We think because we know what we know something about the entire world. And we've gotten away with it because of the genius of America in the 20th century. The 20th century was our century. And I believe we can still be great. I believe we are great. But I believe we have to do some serious looking in the mirror. And I think the arts are going to play a big role. They must come back. And you know who's going to bring it back? You're all going to bring it back. That's my message to you. You've got to do it. Please do it. And take it away with passion. I think I probably ought to stop here. I've kept you up all much too late. Thank you so much for your presence tonight.